So good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to our Planning Portal webinar series. This is the 10th webinar in our series of Planning Portal Past, Present and Future. So welcome to join us today. Today we don't have our Managing Director, Sarah Chilcott, with us, who is on leave this week. Unfortunately for her, COVID has scuppered her plans for a holiday abroad. But she's taking a well-deserved break to recharge her batteries. Hopefully you're all well recovered as well from the football on the weekend. And although it's not coming home, I think we can be proud of the team, the manager and the staff for their really uplifting performances throughout in what was an excellent tournament for the country as a whole. As mentioned on our recent webinars, you will know that our go live date is currently under review. Our solutions team in TerraQuest are continuing to finalise the first stage of development in building the foundations of our application service. The Reef platform site allows us a greater functionality that will enable us to work in a more agile manner and be more responsive to change and implementing improvements. We are developing each component part of making an application in a modular way, which will then be transferable to other services such as online building control applications. In light of this, we are currently defining when development will be complete, but it's not going to be in the next 4 months. As a part of the replatforming, it's vitally important that we are in a position to migrate all of our customers and partners over across to the new system as smoothly and efficiently as possible, to ensure continuity of our service across all applicants, agent and local authority partners. We've lessons learned from having done this before and great strides are being made, but it's important that we get it right. With more than 90% of planning applications going through the portal, that's more than 2,200 each working day, local authorities and agents across England and Wales rely on our service and we don't take that responsibility lightly. We will also be taking a short break from hosting our monthly webinars over the summer period and returning in late September. During this time, we will be changing the webinar software from GoToWebinar, which we're currently on, across to a new platform called Expo Platform. This has more functionality for engagement and interaction and will be used for our virtual annual Planning Portal conference taking place from the 15th to the 18th of November this year. It will also form part of a wider community hub that we're creating for everybody within the industry to utilise. Further details will be sent out over the coming weeks on this as we make the transition across. So you can register for the future Planning Portal webinar and also other events. In the meantime, we'll be working hard behind the scenes on the development so that we have more to show and tell on our return in late September. For today's session, we have an important topic and looking at the legislative changes affecting applications that will come into effect on the 1st of August. As you'll be aware, there is quite a bit of change to permitted development rights and the introduction of a fire statement for relevant proposals classed as high-risk buildings. We have therefore needed to give thought to how we can accommodate these changes smoothly and efficiently for our customers on the current service. And whilst we're in the middle of replatforming it, planning ahead to ensure we cater for them on the new service. For all local authority partners listening in, I'd like to reiterate that we recommend that you are on the latest version of our data standard or schema to ensure that all application types that are currently submitted online are being successfully retrieved into your back office systems. This includes the 16 prior approvals added in December 2019 and the larger home extension application, which is quite popular. This will save you having to manually download them and takes additional resource, which isn't ideal. If you are unsure about this, then please get in touch regarding what data we do make available via the OneApp connectors and the integrations. For professional agents, we recommend that when you upload supporting documentation to your applications, please ensure that you select the appropriate document type that reflects the content of attachments. This is important as both the document type and the file names get passed in data to local authorities to improve their indexing and what gets displayed on their online planning registers. So you'll start to see some of the information that you're given being replicated on those registers. I'm joined today by our policy and strategy advisor, James Garrett, to talk you through the new policy changes. He has planned how we're going to cater for them now, and we'll also run you through this in more detail with a few more slides.
Hello, everyone.
Hiya. As always, if you have any questions or feedback, send it in as we go through the session. And as usual, we'll pick up as many as possible at the end, or if we can't answer the questions then we will respond to you afterwards. Okay. Thank you, James.
Brilliant. So, yeah, as we said, there's quite a lot coming along all at once on the 1st of August. So these are the high level changes. I'll run you through more detail in subsequent slides. So first of all, we're talking about the end of the current material period for previously revoked use classes. This was put in place to allow permit development rights to continue working while the government did the relevant consultations and updates to get them sorted and in line with the new use classes that were introduced last September. Part of that new use class was use class E, commercial business service, which saw a lot of previous uses condensed into one. So these changes also cover a lot of the permit development rights regarding that use class. As Scott previously mentioned, there are changes to mandate the provision of fire statements in relevant applications. This covers both planning permissions and certain types of prior approval. There are shorter determination targets for major public service infrastructure proposals. And while this doesn't affect application requirements when you're submitting them, it will affect local authorities and how they process them and their time periods for doing that. And finally, what I'm going to cover is changes to some of the application fees around some of the prior approval types. So without further ado, can we go on to the next slide? So as I was saying, end of July this year is the deadline established last September by which all the permit development needs to start taking account of the new use classes. So up till now, you will still see Class A, certain Class B uses, etc., in our prior approval questions because they are the ones that are still being used, even though they were revoked in September. Now, the interesting bit about this is that the amending legislation was literally made available on Friday. So while we've been working off the details in the government's technical consultation, we're obviously now making sure we're cross-checking that against the actual legislation to make sure there's no surprises in there. So far from what I've seen, there aren't, but I will reserve judgment until I've completed that analysis. But generally we're talking, you know, the majority of these changes are simple changes. So for example, when something said Class A, it's going to be a like-for-like swap into use Class E. And then there are some more in-depth changes which affect some of the prior approval types we make. For example, some are simply made redundant, so there could be no longer permitted development. For example, change use from casinos to assembly and leisure. Or you might not need to apply. So for something that was a previous right, like changing shops to financial professional services, both of those are now in Class E. So as it's within the same use class, you don't need an application to change the use. Although if there's work associated with it, you might need an application for that. Secondly, some stuff has been superseded. So for example, specific right about changing offices to dwelling houses has been superseded by a broader right that covers the entire use class E, has slightly different limits and conditions and limitations, and will require a different type of prior approval. And then finally, there's some that have been altered in scope. So a lot of them where the broader rights for commercial business and service taken apart, the existing rights now focus specifically on some of the sui generis or uses in their own right. for example, takeaways, which obviously, because they're a use in their own right, they need to be have specific considerations applied to them. So can we have the next slide, please? So the other big part of this is the permit development rights for use class E, commercial business and service use. And as I was referring to before, quite a lot of specific rights have been broadened now to cover any commercial service use. A good example of that is the agricultural buildings, where there was permit development to change to flexible commercial uses. And these were quite specific. They're now much broader under this commercial business service use class. There's also a broader right to change any commercial business service use to dwelling houses. Again, this was used to be covered by specific rights. It's now covered by a catch-all right with its own specific prior approval application type and its own specific limitations, such as the 1500 square meters of floor space upper limit. There's also, as I was saying, changes of use from specific sui generis uses in their own right, i.e. takeaways, to any other commercial business service use. And this covers off a lot of the old specific rights that were in place. And finally, something that came out of the new legislation that's just published is the need for a prior approval application for a change of use to a mixed use where it includes dwelling houses, in this case, a couple of flats. And that's obviously going to allow the local planning authority to consider matters such as access, storage and waste collection, or adequate natural light. Obviously, above all of this, there was another change recently to make sure that any dwelling house delivered under permit development rights has to now meet the minimum space standards. And so these sort of build into an overall picture where local authorities should be better able to at least be aware of these developments and determine if their prior approval will be required. The other big bit about use class E is that it includes nurseries and indoor sport and recreation. Now, nurseries were previously covered in non-residential institutions alongside schools, and indoor sport and recreation was covered in assembly and leisure uses. So these uses being within use class E are now going to be a lot more flexible with what they can change in and out of. Whereas some of the other previous assembly and leisure uses are going to be protected as uses of community value and see some permit development rights withdrawn from them. So can we have the next slide? On to the change we're making to account for all of this. So on the website, you're going to see a lot of updates around our common projects section. So obviously, there's a change of use section within that that details what you can and can't do, what the use classes mean. That's obviously going to be revamped to cover all this, all these changes and consolidations and everything else. But also, there are some additional things where if you're a homeowner, you want to build an extension, some of these new rights are being introduced into the conditions so that, for example, if your house was delivered through one of these new permit development rights, you're then not eligible for subsequent permit development, for example, for an extension or for some of the other homeowner permit development rights. As I say, all the relevant common projects will be updated to cover that. So that's the website. On the online application service, we're going to be putting warnings and sort of what to do next information within the question set. So you can sort of see the screenshot there. That's an example of a type where it no longer includes change of use to nurseries. So again, we're saying if your proposal is to a nursery, you shouldn't continue with this. You need a different type of prior approval. And we can point you in the right direction of that. But if your use is to a state funded school, that's still valid. So we're making sure that through the course of the application, and it will be reflected in sort of wider guidance around the site, that applicants and agents know if they need to stop what they're doing, if they need to change what they're doing, or if they're okay to continue. Also, updates to the application types. So again, you can sort of see an example there of the drop-down list, and we're going to flag applications that are no longer valid. This is also going to carry over to the fee calculator and paper form choosers, and is going to be in the guided chooser, which helps people sort of answer a couple of questions to determine the application types they need. And we're just flagging up that these types are no longer valid. And also updates to the question sets. Obviously, where use classes are changed, we need to update the question sets to be compliant with legislation and ensure they reference the current use classes, not the revoked one, once the material period ends. Or for example, if a question is no longer relevant, we're going to update the options to make it obvious that that's the case. Finally, PDF forms. Obviously, while we provide, you know, a set of application types on through the online service, we also provide them as printable paper forms for anyone who wants to do it the old-fashioned way. But equally, application types that aren't covered on the online service, we provide as fillable PDF forms to facilitate email submission. So we're going to carry across all these updates we're making on the online system over to our PDF forms and have new forms for the new application types. Additionally, where the prior approval types are no longer required, we're going to put a message on those forms to state that's the case and ensure that people don't submit them. So onto the fire statement, next slide. So the provision of fire statements is part of meeting the requirements of Planning Gateway 1, which was one of the actions that came out of the response to Grenfell. And we've also recently seen the Building Safety Bill published, which is going to go through Parliament. But this initial focus, it's something they can do without that bill, is the upfront consideration of fire safety, i.e. as part of the planning process. And as it stands at the moment, they've updated the development management procedure through legislation to basically mean that you're building a tall building that contains residential accommodation, so it's more than one dwelling house or flat, and the building's 18 meters or more in height or seven or more stories, it's going to be a validation requirement mandatory to submit a fire statement as part of the planning, or as I refer to, prior approval application. And that fire statement's going to have to be completed by an expert. We're also aware that some local authorities have requirements in their local list for submission of fire statements. So by making these changes to the system, they're also going to be able to access that through their planning application requirement settings. And the other note on this slide, the short determination targets for major public service infrastructure proposals, as we say, that's not going to affect application requirements. But where proposals are picked up for this type of development, it will affect the timescales, and local authorities will have to meet those things. So, sorry, onto the next slide, please. Again, covering the changes we're making. We've obviously got on the website, we've got what you need to submit. We've got various guidance information around the planning application process. So we're going to be updating that. With details about the fire statements, like we have previously for likes of design access statements and such, to flag up that they are mandatory for relevant applications. Equally, as you can see with the examples on the description of the proposals, we're going to call out the fact that fire statements are required, linked to the guidance and the template. And for this, we're linking straight to gov.uk to use the official MHCLG template. Which, like SIL, they're providing as a standard document, and also call out public service infrastructure changes and links to the relevant information. What we're also going to do, obviously, is make sure you can attach these fire statements by adding them as a supporting document type. And like I say, that is going to be optional within the relevant application types, and also open for local planning authorities to use in their own local planning application requirements through their admin functions on the application service. And finally, on the PDF forms, we're going to either add the additional question, which would be in the case of prior approvals, so it's a matter for prior approvals, so you need to submit some information and or the checklist items to call out the need for the fire statement to be submitted if relevant to ensure the application is valid. Next slide, please. So finally, just to cover off some of the changes to the fees that are also happening, it was good to see government getting through this through in Parliament in time. So it actually takes effect on 30th of July, which is in time for all these other updates on the 1st of August. That hasn't always been the case. So the commercial business service to dwelling houses is currently a £96 flat fee for various types of these applications. That's going to change to a fee of £100 per dwelling house, but also with the exemptions that if you've done a similar planning application for the same site and paid a fee for that, it'll be exempt, or for the single free go second application if you need to submit a revised proposal. And well, the other one is that £96 fee is going to be introduced for the enlargement of dwelling house by construction of additional stories. This, from what we can see, has been by far the most popular type in terms of an order of magnitude of the prior approval types that are introduced by government in autumn last year. So, and up till now has effectively been free to submit. So we know local authorities are keen to get some of the costs back on the processing of these application types. And, you know, the fee at £96, it's a relatively low fee, sort of a very small percentage of any of the overall costs of the work. The other thing to note is the new prior approval type they introduced in the legislation around changing commercial business service or sui generis to mixed use with a couple of flats. That is going to be covered by the existing legislation and sort of the blanket £96 change of use fee that applies to any of those prior approval types. So that won't be one that sort of slips through the cracks and is submissible for free as and when it's introduced. What might happen though, as we've seen with other types, is government might introduce a further amendment which calls out the application specifically and maybe applies some specific exemptions or other things to it. So that's it in terms of the details of the changes. Sorry, it's been a bit of a whistle-stop tour. Obviously, if you've got any questions about any of that in more detail, do feel free to get in touch or raise them in the comments. But if we move on to the next slide, where we can talk about what's to come on our current service and new platform. So obviously, all these changes I've talked through, we're putting that through as content amends, and the main reason for that is we can get that done quickly, obviously with the final legislation just being published end of last week and the 1st of August only being a few weeks away. We're going to push that through as content updates, but what we're also doing now, all these changes have been confirmed in legislation, is get a change request through with our supplier to actually stop creation and submission of the redundant application types. Now what that will probably look like is you'll see the types that are no longer valid disappearing from the choosers, and you'll, if you have an existing one, you'll probably no longer be able to copy it, or if you try and submit it, you'll get a pop-up warning. Now obviously ideally you wouldn't have started in the first place, but we appreciate there's a lot of draft applications of this type in the system, and it's just going to be a catch to save everyone time. Basically, you're gonna not have to deal with payments for stuff and trying to get refunds. LPAs won't be receiving these application types, so that is something that we're looking to introduce in the coming months. Obviously that's what we're doing on the current service, but the theme of these webinars overall is the new platform we're working towards, and on that, as Scott mentioned, it's going to be much more agile and much easier for us to implement change and respond more rapidly to user requests or feedback. So one of the key things we're obviously very keen to do, no one needs to tell us, is the online implementation of all these missing prior approval application types. So these include the ones that are introduced last year, the couple that are coming through now on the 1st of August, and making sure everything can be delivered through the online system and realizing the benefits of that. On top of that, going back to that, what we'll likely do with that, as was proven with the previous introduction of prior approvals, is get those applications on the online system first and then subsequently release a schema update. As I say, this was proven last time as the best way of, you know, enabling the benefits for everyone without having to have everyone catch up and support the latest version of the data standard, which I know can be tricky in some situations. Moving on to the next point, and we want to deliver improvements to validation and configuration for the national and local requirements. So we covered it in a previous webinar, but we're introducing specific types for all the different plans and drawing types. That's going to help. We're going to mandate descriptions for document types that might not necessarily be obvious by their type. But we're also looking at introducing additional logic around the national and local requirements so we can implement better conditional rules, for example, around fire statements, to say, well, if someone ticks a box to say this building qualifies for a fire statement, then we're going to make sure you have to submit one before you submit your application. Flood risk assessment's another good example of that. If you're in a flood zone, you need a flood risk assessment. And say, trying to front load some of that validation work in the application process so you don't get so many invalid applications submitted. And then the final point is updates to our data standard. So we want to make more information directly available as data. Now, obviously, some of that comes from these missing types and new stuff we're introducing. Some of that, for example, could be the answers to all the eligibility questions for prior approval. They're currently surfaced in the PDF application form, but not in the schema, because they were initially developed as a logic to block or allow submission. But we know that is useful information to LPAs. They want to see that. It also fulfills the overall idea of the golden thread around building control to sort of pass a lot of data through the system and keep it constant and a maintainable record. And we know we've got requests from the likes of the SIL forms and potentially the fire statement going forward to all have that as data on the system rather than as a support document type. The other point about facilitating improvements to optimization and automation, that's more about information around, for example, the supporting documents, so potentially statuses and other things which will allow local authority systems to better process them and realize the benefits of doing all that as data and computer led and allowed to focus resources on the other key matters of the service. So that's it from me. Scott, I don't know if you want to add anything else on these, or if we want to open up for questions.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for that, James. There's quite a lot that you covered in there. We'll make sure we've had a request for the slides, so I'll make sure that we send round today's recording and the slides. We got a question in that I think I can pick up from a local authority. How do I get access to the updated and new paper forms for our website? So I'd say, you know, whether you're a local authority or an agent, you'll be able to access them via our online paper forms chooser, which sits on the Planning Portal website. We'll also send through a link to that in the post-event comms. For local authorities, we recommend that rather than hosting copies of the branded forms on your website, that you link to the forms chooser, as this ensures that you get your correct branded forms. And they're always up to date and legislatively accurate. So, however, we always try to encourage online submission. You know, if they're online, then it makes sense to submit online.
Yeah, the only other thing I'll add to that, Scott, was that we also produce a sort of a spreadsheet of all the links, all the sort of direct URLs to all these form types, and a list of all the LPA codes, which if LPAs don't want to link to the form chooser or the form section directly, what they can do is link to the specific forms, and this the spreadsheet providing the details of all the links to do that, as well as all the links to all our guidance, all our notices, all our help text. So again, sometimes, you know, like I said, they want a direct link to the form, not the PDF, so that's going to be out there. We publish details of that on the Knowledge Hub. We'll make it available elsewhere, and also on the Knowledge Hub, I note there's a change log which details, again, in detail, all the changes we're making to the application system and all the changes to the paper forms. So that'll be updated as these come online. If you're looking for more detail of these changes, The only other thing I would flag is that we've also got a post on our blog, which I broadly based my presentation on, which again covers all these changes at a high level. And we're also happy to accept any more questions on the actual detail, because I appreciate there is a lot of detail behind this. I've tried to give a high level overview and not go too deep into it, because I know that's not for everyone. But if it's for you, do get in touch if you want to know.
Okay, yeah, just one final question. I'm just conscious of time. And you did cover off elements of this, James. When might these changes be added to the replatform site? So I suppose in terms of the prioritization, so, you know, good question. We're currently factoring in all these changes so that following go live of the replatform service, we can then prioritize and make them available. So effectively, we're working in an agile manner, which means that they form part of a backlog of change. However, firstly, it's important that we go live as it is, as we have integrations with all the local authorities, and we don't want to disrupt that. We then need to introduce a new data standard with the changes that we will communicate out to IT suppliers. But we're currently working on that in the interim anyway, as we can prepare for that change.
The other thing is that any changes we make on the current system will carry over as is day one on the new platform. You know, I guess to reiterate what we've said in previous presentations and communications, we're really focused on the business continuity here. You know, it's an in-flight service. It processes, you know, the majority of applications in the country. What we don't want to do is pull that rug from under you on day one. We want agents, applicants, all our users to be able to go on there, make their applications. We want the LPAs to submit them. We don't want it throwing up errors. We don't want to introduce something which, you know, maybe an amazing improvement, but maybe potentially breaks the system as it is on day one. So we're gonna have that business continuity, and then that new platform will let us introduce all this other good stuff down the line.
Yeah, and just to add on that, what has worked well previously is that we can introduce them to our online service prior to the integration with local authorities. We know that the local authorities have called for that previously, and this means that applicants will have access to a national standard single submission channel via the planning portal that local authorities then can easily access to process them, whilst the suppliers develop their systems to retrieve the application and the data. Okay, well, thanks to James for providing a comprehensive overview of the policy changes today, and to you for taking the time to dial in and listen to today's webinar. We'll load the video up on YouTube with the other episodes in the series later today, and plan to see you again later in September for the further updates on progress after the summer break. In the meantime, if you do have any questions or feedback, please do get in touch with any of the team via the usual channels, and look to see you again soon. Thank you.